It is my privilege to know Dr. Bob Pierce as a close personal friend and confidant during his developing vision and founding of World Vision. When I first met Bob at a Youth for Christ banquet in Chicago, I remember he had a great burden to reach young people for Christ. He also had a vision for helping underprivileged people in various parts of the world that he had heard or read about. I believe perhaps his greatest achievement was in the founding of World Vision and later Samaritan's Purse.
My name is Bob Pierce, speaking for World Vision.
I think God laid his hand on my husband's heart and called him into ministry for a specific reason, and that was to become the organization that we have today. But I think it began a long time ago.
When Youth for Christ started in the 1940s, part of its focus was U.S. servicemen. So Bob Pierce joined in 1945, and one of the first things he was asked to do was to lead some rallies in Seattle, which was where, of course, a lot of the soldiers were shipping out to the Pacific Theater of World War II.
On Saturday night, we go down to the Moore Theater. And so the boys are waiting to take off, would be walking down around there. And they'd come up to this theater, and outside would say, "Join us, have a good time, singing and getting acquainted, come on in." And it would be Youth for Christ. They used to have them lined up at the altar. Because we had Billy Graham, we had Cliff Barrows, we had Merv Rizal, we had all the best speakers come in. Seattle was our home for about 3 years. Yeah, loved it.
It was a generation of young men who were creating as they went, and they shared what they learned, and they inspired one another, and they encouraged one another.
In 1947, Bob Pierce was in China to speak to university students in Amoy, a small island off the coast of China. A missionary named Tina Holkelbor had asked him to come and speak at her girls' school, and that's the scene of where he met a little girl who changed his heart and made him understand that the spiritual side and the physical side need to come together in a ministry.
After one of your religious meetings in Amoy off the coast of China, a little girl comes up to you and says that she's unable to continue school because her family has no money.
I was serving as your interpreter, Dr. Bob, and I impulsively said, "What would you do in a case like that?"
Now, you remember that day back in 1947, Dr. Bob?
Is that Tina Holkelbor?
Certainly. And here she is from Grand Rapids, Michigan, Tina Holkelbor.
Bless your heart. God bless you, dear. How wonderful to see you.
Oh. What did Dr. Bob do then, Ms. Holkelbor?
As he always does, of course, if there's money in his pocket and if there's a cause that's worthy, why, he dug down deep into his pocket. And he gave her what she needed. And it seems that that was the beginning of the great organization that Dr. Bob established, that is World Vision.
You attacked the problem with your usual furious energy.
Dr. Paul Reese said there was something remarkably unpremeditated about our origin when he was talking about the beginning of World Vision. It was started as a missionary service organization, which means that it was there to channel funds toward missionaries.
Because really at that time in World Vision's history, our focus was really helping others who were on the field doing amazing things and making a huge difference.
And when he was showing his films and he was talking about the children, he also talked about these hands and feet of Christ.
So my dad took these movies and he brought them back to the States and he showed them in churches.
I don't remember whether it was 1947 or 48. We got word from the Youth for Christ International office that Bob Pierce had just returned from China and had movies. It was just the raw footage of what later became the movie China Challenge.
Seems only yesterday that I stood in my hotel room in the heart of China, watching an Oriental city come to life. Who can forget the padding of straw-sandaled feet along ancient thoroughfares and the clatter of hurrying rickshaws?
It was an amazing thing to bring to a church, this footage that maybe nobody else had seen. It hadn't been in newsreels. We can't sort of understand the impact of that now, since we have so much access to communications and the media is ubiquitous. But then it was a real, really personal view. But that is an unusual thing for an evangelist to do. I don't know that there are any other evangelists who are doing that.
Bob, of course, preached a gospel message and invited people to become Christians, and a whole bunch of young people came forward to confess Christ as Savior.
It was my privilege, after the film was released, to go out on the road, and we would present a brief concert and then show the World Vision film.
He showed the movies and gave a call for missionary service and a call for financial support.
I never met Bob Pierce personally, but I knew Bob Pierce because my parents took me to some of his rallies. And the one thing I would say is I learned quickly that my dad should keep his checkbook at home, because Bob Pierce had a way to engage with people and with his stories that not only the tears flow, but the money flowed too.
Yes, I remember when Bob Pierce was going to take an offering, he said, "Ushers, close the doors."
He was working out of the Youth for Christ office in Portland, and that's where he was when World Vision was founded, to support missionaries overseas. When he had an opportunity to go to Korea in 1950, he took it.
He wanted to find out what was happening, gather the stories, and come back and let people here know what was really going on.
And he came back to America with a burning heart, saying, "Why can't we have people in America who will just, without even a sacrificial gift, but month by month, give a pittance for the support of a child in some needy part of the world?" And I tell you, that concept took hold.
From his travels in Korea, Bob Pierce realized that Korean pastors most needed encouragement and training. So he started pastors' conferences to provide that. And the first one was in 1953.
So at the end of the war, he wanted to get the pastors together to encourage them.
Bring the pastors together, but more than that, you bring in the greatest preachers and the greatest theologians to teach them the deeper truths and the deeper things of God, and inspire them, get them excited. And pastors' conferences were going on all over the world.
We moved down from Portland with World Vision to Eagle Rock, California, and we were the World Vision Quartet, sang on the ABC radio broadcast, 130 stations, from 56 to the end of 1960.
My name is Bob Pierce, speaking for World Vision, reporting on the activities of those unique people we call missionaries, who are serving your Savior and carrying the cross.
What I remember most about that is that it was so kind of just warm and folksy. It wasn't a professional production, in that my dad would just talk and tell stories.
Let's turn to the World Vision Quartet. They're going to sing for us.
It may not be on the mountains height or over the stormy sea.
We went to Asia in 1955, visited six countries in 9 weeks, and sang in Korea with Bob Pierce on South Mountain. They flew over the crowd and estimated there were 70,000 people there. They spent more time praying than they did speaking.
Bob Pierce continued to be an evangelist, and the way he incorporated that into World Vision's ministry is holding these large-scale crusades, the first one in 1957 in Seoul, Korea, and the second one in Osaka, Japan, in 1959.
As long as he had breath and had an audience, he was telling people about Christ.
I hope that whoever you are, wherever you're listening today, you will let your heart be broken with the things that break the heart of God.